Welcome back to Blacker Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We're back to discuss the premiere of Season 2 of Vikings Valhalla on Netflix. This premiere, January 12th of 2023, we are going to be getting a 8-episode season with Season 3 already renewed. So we have that sweat off of our back. So we know we at least we're going to get a pretty thought out story arc for these three seasons as they unfold. And I thought this was a really good setup for what we are going to explore. Before we do jump into the recap, wherever you listen to this podcast, Podbean, Stitcher, iTunes, Spotify, go down to the rating section, drop some stars, leave a review. My social media will be there as well. And if you want to send feedback on Vikings Valhalla or any other show that I do, blackercouch@gmail.com. The Web of Fate was written by Jeb Stuart and directed by Cyrian Donnelly. I gave this episode a 9.2 out of 10. As stated, it really got us on the paths that we needed to, while also really wrapping up a lot of the baggage from season one. But some people getting fates that feel appropriate, while others getting fates that are sadly overdue. We start with Leaf, who's been out just kicking names, taking ass. We don't have a time frame, but I'm going to say it's more than 6 months because it would need more than 6 months for that wound that was very life-threatening to heal. I'm going to say ever since Liv's death, he's been out in them streets or forests in full berserker mode.
You tell him I'm coming and hell's coming with me, you hear?
He's tracking soldiers from Olaf's camp when they're heading back to said camp. Kills them. Too late though. Someone else has gotten his man before him, and that poor soldier just wanted to die obliviously and was heading to that path until you fucked with his wound, reminding him of the pain of being alive. So good for you, sir. That was to definitely prove we're getting a much more cruel life than we used to know. But when he yelled and kicked that stool with that shield on it, I was like, I need you to mean it. I'm yelling at my screen.
He needs some milk!
And that certainly is not the appropriate response for how I should be reacting to that moment. The man himself, Olaf, is being carted back to Kattegat in disgrace and butt-ass naked. That made me happy. All of his shivering made me just really relish some things inside. Freydis and Harold, meanwhile, have been playing house outside of Kattegat, which she is rather content at because it's a peaceful life. Living off the land, being very eat, pray, love. What's the other word they use for it? Hippie. The hippie type of lifestyle. You know, we want to worship the trees and the gods and sacrifice some lambs every couple of seasons. I don't understand what the big deal is. However, Harold wants to claim what is his from Forkbeard by returning to Kattegat, something she doesn't see as happening since Canute promised him Norway, not his father. She is concerned for his safety, but he wants their children to be nobles, kings, anything that has to do with what he feels is his birthright. And I get it, because you've been indoctrinated into that belief from the time you're very young. What can you just can't let that shit go. It may be a very egotistical, egomaniacal thing to say, but it is what the line of power is, what succession is. They've been raised that this is something they get to inherit. And by the decree of the people who co-signed most of this shit, so as long as the people's happy, ultimately, don't give a fuck about what's happening. I hate to bust it to you, but that was society for a very long time. But he really wants to pursue that, whereas she is really happy on the peasantry side. Freydis must think her brother dead, I thought, by the way, she did not mention his name. But no, she let him do his thing, Waldy, because he'll always be close to her heart. That's all she has to think about him. Think about him at. But he clearly was left to wander the world on this witch hunt while losing his sanity, seeing as the ghost of Liv is not only with him, but he is interacting with her. And that's when you know that things is not okay, when you're in the forest alone and you're talking to yourself, but then when you're talking to someone else that you think is having a conversation with you back, that's when you might want to, I don't know, seek some counseling. Too bad the seer can't be up in this post. See, this is what happens. You fuck up the whole system and now everybody can't go get the counseling they need. Rattle some bones and shit. In Kattegat, a noose is prepared for Olaf, who sits in a cage, harassed and bullied, when Canute's hand-fasted wife, Aslug, that's what I'm going to call her now, because I cannot pronounce her first name, Aslug 2.0 arrives. And as soon as I saw that little kid, I was like, is that Magnus? Only reason I even know his name is because he looks like another Magnus. And that is just a reference you won't get until you get it. In London, Canute sends word to his wife of his victories, but not when he's bringing his ass home. And he expresses continued concern about her safety, something Godwin is passing along to the king. But she isn't threatened about talk in alehouses. She thinks the security is just fine. There's a look between he and Geetha, and sure enough, in the next scene, they have already consummated their eye fucks from last season. And their affair, which he wants to make official once Canute returns, is something they are keeping from Emma. He assures her he takes all threats seriously, as when you have lost everything as he has, you want to ensure it never happens again. She asks what his dreams are, and he desires a loving home with children who will one day rule their own kingdoms around the world. Keynote, not just singular conquests. You have now the legacies of these men, and yes, they are propagated by men, that want dynasties, whichever you prefer. This is what the Vikings actually did accomplish. The Kievan Rus, going up to Ireland, Scotland, England, a lot of Europe. The Vikings were able to send their sons and their sons of their sons out and conquer the world and have that Viking connection, even though they certainly distanced themselves from their Viking ancestry once Christianity got a much firmer hold into the world, particularly after the collapse of the Second Roman Empire, the Byzantine Empire. That is neither here nor there. He wants his eldest, who will be wise and special, to be the King of England, something that is a dream, but not an impossible one considering the line of succession does not include them, even if he marries Canute's sister. And this is the second loving relationship we've seen in the show, with men consistently in the position of ambition and power, hence security, for their legacies. And the women, while certainly along for the ride, are not quite all Emma, who is heavily involved in securing that place for herself in history, not just alongside her husband, but on the throne, as we saw her receiving. Freyd is taking a drink, sees a wolf in the stream, and I'm like, I've seen that screensaver before. I'm not gonna rag on the effects too much, but says not HBO. The seer pop up out of absolutely nowhere.
The fuck you doing here, nigga? Identify yourself. Who the fuck are you?
How you not a bird, but the sound of wings flap when you show up? He draws something in the sand and tells her, you gotta man the fuck up. The pagan world needs you. Riddle fashioned.
English, motherfucker, do you speak it?
She goes back, brushes past her man, finds her sword, announces that she is going to Kattegat with Harold. I thought we already discussed this at length. You nodded. What do you mean? You're going with me. In Kattegat, Jojo, that's what I'm calling him. I think it's Jojener, but I'm not going to do that. Recognizes Leif and... Is it Leif or Leif? I guess it's Leif. Because I know I'm saying it wrong. He recognizes Leif and knows that man needs an intervention, so gets some ale and tries to get invited to sit with him in obvious fanboying of trying to find out where his sister is. When he realizes Leif won't kill him when he tells him to go away, he sits and offers the man a drink that he didn't want either.
Hell yeah, now we got business.
Then goes back to his original questioning of, so where are your sister? You think she gonna show up here? Because she should totally want to see Olaf get his just desserts, something Leif wants to guarantee. Olaf, naked, is tossed in the cell and is visited by Forkbeard, who tells him he hates traitors. And despite what Canute promised afterwards to Harald, Norway was never his to take. Forkbeard doesn't intend to kill him.
No!
No!
Fucking no!
And furthermore,
why?
That certainly did not sit well in my goodies. But then the rest of the scene unfolded and I was like, God damn, chef's kiss. I love Forkbeard. Forkbeard reminds me, it's the same thing. I really want them to do that parallel between Forkbeard and Canute and Leif and his father when, and hopefully if they introduce him into the show, because as much as Canute is the great king of, because he's the king of Norway, he was the king of Sweden, and he's the king of England, Forkbeard's father really set the tone for that. You know what I mean? And put that in motion, and he kind of, you know, he was raised by a good man, a great man. And we got the same thing with Godwin wanting the same thing for his son in the future, but he doesn't have that right now. And then you have, well, you do have the idea that should, or if, probably not, Harald's to learn of his possible son, how he wants him to be the king of, right? And then you have the other last person, being Leif and his father about the expedition to America, because there is, it's like, those are two different sagas, but they both could be true. It could be Leif or it could be his father that led that expedition. Most people go with Leif, but others believe that, yeah, could have probably also been him and his father ended up dying, and then his son took over. But his father certainly is the king of Greenland. He tells him he has made Sveinn king of Norway, Forkbeard, that is, to which Olaf laughs, knowing he'll be dead in 3 weeks, killed by the Jarls, because they'll never accept him, but he won't. Because considering what Olaf accomplished, raising an army in secret, so on and so forth, making the political moves you did, means you have potential and you have loyalty here. So I can use that to protect my grandson, something that, of course, is laughed at in his face. And he says, I would rather die than see the success of that boy. However, Forkbeard delivers his blow by revealing Magnus, whom he loves dearly, and tells him tit for tat, you show him how to be king and I will show your son the same courtesy. But if anything should happen to the boy, well, that will be the last time Magnus breathes.
What up, gangsta?
It is rather brilliant because death is easy for you. Being made to be the stand-in for someone you consider so unworthy, but not only do you have to protect them and guarantee their safety at the loss of your beloved child, but you would have rather died than see that. And now you're forced to shovel it into your mouth every single day. And everyone knows that you're there at the behest of him. So no, I think that's rather, despite how this plays out with how this affects our people, which unfortunately don't have too many dogs in the fight. This is a rather brilliant move on Forkbeard's part, because he knows that his son will never be accepted here. And despite the fact that Forkbeard certainly supported Canute and his marriage to Emma, it's clear that he has a soft spot for his grandsons as well by the hand-fasted wife, which makes and made him a lot more lenient with his daughter-in-law. First, as soon as I heard that, I was like, oh, Leif is not going to take that news well. But luckily, he has other things that become a priority. So that was smart on the script. He then goes to deal Forkbeard with Aslug 2.0 to yell at her about her treachery, but has also decided to spare her life. She had some audacity thinking she should simply go back to being comfortable and in charge of her destiny. I'm at the edge of nowhere on Earth. You better be glad you're still on this Earth, bitch. Forkbeard announces these new changes to a very disappointed crowd.
Oh my God, bro.
Oh, hell no, man. What the fuck, man?
Get your ass on, boy.
Get your goddamn ugly ass on.
Bruised, recently humiliated in front of everyone in a way you can't feel like dirt on the inside, no matter how much you try to make up for it, he is able to turn the crowd against himself to a united foe, which is the pagans, because now that they have condemned Freydis as a witch and Harold as a usurper, the lie is spread that a heathen army is on its way to Kattegat to dethrone them. So he offers 3 chests of gold for their heads. You see that Forkbeard really wasn't like on board with this, but at the same time, whatever method gets what needs to do, and weapon religion is often utilized as a weapon. I mean, ask how many unpopular kings, or correlate, I should say, how many unpopular, right when those stats start to drop those ratings, all of a sudden there's some type of religious conflict or the persecution of Jews. One or the other that usually follows when the king is not showing himself to be a great ruler. Also, using fear as a scare tactic to get people in line or to shift the narrative, so to speak, versus, oh no, I'm in charge now and I'm going to protect you all. I know you want to hate me and I totally understand these feelings, but guess what? I'm going to protect your lives because there's a threat to your lives and I'm going to show you what it's all about. Leif wants to kill him, but hearing his sister and new brother be put up for ransom, not really ransom, bounty is the word I'm looking for, he decides to go warn them instead. And the two are out fishing. Really, though, if you plan to go back to Kattegat, why not send little birdies? Where's your allies, Harold? You're putting a lot on one man's word and your own entitlement, and that's not a smart play, ever. You should have had some inkling of what you were walking into before you just was casually going to walk your ass into it. You stopped people. People was walking on the road, and you didn't stop and ask no questions. You need to be prepared to be a better ruler versus just going around saying, I'm entitled to be a ruler. Him and the buff, though. He definitely been at the gym, putting on some muscle. Freydis is recognized by a girl who thinks she is the prophesized leader of the people, keeper of the faith. However, she's like, no, I don't know who you're talking about. I don't know who that is. Keep this idol, little girl. They are escaping in little boats to another boat that's going to meet them out on the water to take them to a place called Jomsborg, one or the other, since the Christians are not allowing the pagans to rebuild after they burned all their shit down. Surprise, surprise. In Londonum, which is probably how you would have said it back then, London, while in mass, Emma is the only devout one there as she remained with her eyes closed, whereas Geetha and Godwin are exchanging looks, thinking about what they did last night.
But there, he's flirting with the devil.
I'm also going to be really surprised if Emma doesn't have this card already up her sleeve. Because the amount of times they be looking at each other in long drawn out pauses, I know I'll be looking behind my shoulder like, what you looking at? And I feel like she's the kind of woman that would have birdies in her castle telling her things that she needs to know that Godwin ain't telling her, but we shall see. He senses something is amiss, which it is since the friar poisoned the body of Christ, no less. And he waited entirely too long to say something before the sweaty man runs away. He is able to disguise himself when losing the soldiers and going into a house. However, he is picked up at the gate when he tries to leave. And that's the great thing about Londonderry at this time is there is only one gate in the city, one gate out of the city. So makes for a pretty, pretty nice place to build oneself a fortress. I was wrong. Leaf stayed around in Caddagat, which is good because I knew that ferryman was going to snitch him out. He kept looking over as soon as he said, the keeper of the faith, where? I heard there's like $3.2 million for their capture. And all I got to do really is show you where I last saw them. But you would think if he's helping the pagans, wouldn't he be a friend of the keeper of the faith?
Pussy ass bitch.
He probably say, ain't nobody gonna know it's me. He isn't the only one looking, though. Leaf or Leif. Why do I keep wanting to say Leaf? Leif, that is. I know it's Mimi's fault. I just know how she feels about that uncalled for attack. But Leif sees JoJo creeping out the shadows. Freydis feels ashamed she is running from her fate as pagans look to her for guidance and she gives them doubts. The forehead thing is so overdone, it means nothing anymore. Everyone does it. If you do it with your kid, it's just not even sexual. It's just weird. Both parents watch their children, him and Aslug 2.0, depart with Forkbeard, who doesn't worry about trusting Olaf, because Olaf has to worry about trusting him more so because he holds way more cards in his deck. To give credit to Olaf, and I don't want to, but he knows I've been put in my place. I've committed these acts and, didn't work out for me. Now I get a new path forward. I'm going to commit to that because while I don't get to sit on that throne, my son does. So if I can ensure his future by literally and figuratively doing so, then that's my fate. That's my new calling. And he's perfectly fine with that. So Aslug didn't need to be like, don't talk me anymore about your machinations. He's like, one, I'm no longer that ambitious. And two, you failed yourself. That was not me. You listened to yourself. I just put out a proposal. You didn't have to agree. She vows never to trust him again. And he says, well, just give me a little bit of time because you do have power here as Queen Regent. And if we intend to be happy and content for the rest of our days in our self, well, not self-imposed prison, but you get what I'm saying. Then I suppose we make the best of it. Olaf is then told that Harald's whereabouts have been found and he plans to join the bounty hunters, with this being Savine's first lesson. The reaction to the crowd when they say he was the new king, they was not happy about it at all. Leif kills all of the bounty hunters, including the snitch. And while Freydis is happy to see her brother, he said, we don't do hugs no more.
Emotional damage.
Apparently, Harald don't know what bounty hunter means or what a bounty means, because he talking about how they need to go back to Caddagat so he can explain his situation to his brother. There's no negotiating, sir. He wants you and your witch dead. It took him way too long to realize that he betrayed him first and thought for some reason his brother was going to be like, okay. Back in London, Godwin definitely came in that room to say one thing and one thing only.
I told you. What did I tell you? Didn't I tell you? 'Cause I told you. Mm-hmm. And when did I tell you? A long time ago. And what did I say will happen when I told you? Exactly what just happened.
Which got me thinking. I'm going to say my thoughts, but it definitely got me thinking. And I bet you any amount of money that Mimi's thinking the exact same. The ladies' maids are grateful at his solicitous, is that the correct word, manner, with Emma reluctantly apologizing for not trusting him. But can we? He has very naked ambition to something not within his reach, and this indebtedness is certain to ingratiate himself further into the power. And why would those be, why would people be against Emma? I guess that's my biggest question. That maybe I'm just too involved in the realism of it. Because I know the Vikings brought basically peace to England at this time. Because it was a shit show prior. They bought stability for a really long time. Like, they got everything in together the way it needed to under Canute and Emma. So I don't know why anyone would want her removed, other than, I suppose, a plot from the other type of earls. But I don't know. Who would they actually think to put in her? What, there's no, like, I don't know who could be a contender other than the Vikings themselves or Godwin. So that's why I'm staring at him. This, him being, remaining humble servant to the king's own mercy, that could be true. Like, hey, he could have killed me and I've been given a second chance and I already wasn't liked by my people before. So let me capitalize on this opportunity. That could still be true. But on the other side, I'm still looking at you because you're an opportunist. And opportunists are always going to be putting themselves first. I don't know how she missed, once again, that long lingering look. That was not at her. Freydis tells her brother he's got the look of Papa in his eyes. He tries to shrug it off, however, his absolute ruthlessness when Jojo shows up, clearly unarmed, indicates that he is in fact really hardened. Only when she recognizes the tattoo from the vision that, or not even from the vision, what the seer drew for her, does she tell him to lead the way. Turns out that he is a part of a group of pirates, ocean pirates, that have taken in all of the refugees from the Purge. Harold wants to go to Novgorod, one or the other, which is in the Kievan Rus, also formerly known as, or currently known as, Russia. I think at that time it included parts of Ukraine and Belarus. Don't quote me on that. Orthodox Christianity certainly comes from Viking and Christian marriages, but him having another damn half brother, how many do you have? But it also speaks to exactly what Godwin, a Christian Englishman, has the same dreams that Vikings are already doing. Like, yeah, this guy, he rules the Kievan Rus. I'll just tell him that Forkbeard is an oathbreaker and he'll give me an army to take back Norway for myself. But no more persecutions for pagans once I am king of Norway, because they're going to cohabitate. Greenlanders square up to take their last stand on the beach while Harold says, I suppose I can't fight two against one, and so I'm going to mitigate loss of life as much as possible by getting people out of the direct line of fire. Freydis talks to her brother, knowing he talks to live, and thinks that despite him no longer believing, it is he who is holding on to her instead of her letting or holding on to him, because she wants to go to Valhalla. Hearing this, he may start to heal? She shares, Freydis, with him that she is with child and that he cannot tell Harold, as she will not allow her child to be ruler of a Christian land. She then goes to speak with the man himself, and the two rather amicably break up, knowing they both are on different, they want different futures. They envision their futures in different ways. And eventually it will lead to heartache, to heartbreak, because they're not going to be able to come to a compromise. So time to leave it while it's in a happy place, whereas he becomes king, and then he asks her to become her queen, and then she cannot, and then there's a child, and he wants what's rightfully his, which is his son, to follow in his footsteps and get his birthright, which is something she definitely intends with all of her soul to keep away from him. So, there is that. And she's queen of her own people, and I like how they had this conversation. Because it's clear that they love each other very, very, very much. But at some point, that's going to become a sticking point. And you can, and they did have a happy marriage in between, but that's still a long way off. And Harold, God bless him, if he really wants this army, it's just not going to be done by, let's go after the Oathbreaker. Sure, but this man also has a lot of power and three kingdoms, or at least his son's about to. So I do not think that someone in the Kievan Rus is going to be that inclined to be invested in the politics of Kattegat. At least that's just my assumption. I could be absolutely wrong, and his brother-in-law is all gung-ho for it, but just like he's naive about betraying one brother, a half-brother, and then, you know, thinking he could just have a conversation with him, I think he's naive in thinking he could just get an army. Most of these things are done via alliance, and that alliance is usually through marriage. And if you ain't got a hand to offer, then what is it really in for that noble house that's going to be sacrificing all of their men for you? So while I believe Freydis is going to remain the love of his life, as Mimi would say, there's going to be choices he's going to have to make in the future. Really hard choices, particularly if he's as committed to the dream as he clearly is, he's going to have to start thinking outside of the, you know, the PG-13 world he's been living in. Just as they are cornered on the beach when Olaf's men track them down, flaming balls block Olaf's army, allowing the others to get safely to the boats and roll away in the fog. I thought the fog was a good touch because Olaf had no idea there was backup, and it did give a plausible way for them to get away with the inclusion of the fireballs. But them just watching, like, there was a little bit of a disconnect in the reaction of the fireballs on both sides of the smoke screen there. Like, you're not going to be that close to those types of explosions and not be ducking. You're not just going to be just like, oh, let me just stare at it once again. You're like, what the fuck's going on? Olaf's panic look after being half smug a second ago was satisfying.
How could this happen to me? I made my mistakes. Got nowhere to run. The night goes on as I'm fading away. I'm sick of this life. I just want to scream. How could this happen to me?
You would think that, man, you would think that all the humiliation he suffered in the last 24 to 72 hours, he would not ever go into anything smug. But I guess he really wasn't that smug. He's just like, kill them all! With the close-up of his brother being like, you're gonna kill me? And still looking shocked. The trio then go their separate paths and journeys, with poor Harold gonna need a minute more.
My first love broke my heart for the first time, and I was like,
seeing Freydis have her own story arc that isn't reliant on a man, good choice. Cannot take that away. The other story arc that leads them away from their settlements out into the world, even better. I like all of the things that they are laying down for us as a foundation to move Vikings and their stories into more of the, you know, we've gotten all of the in between. I mean, we've gotten the William the Conqueror and afterwards. We've gotten everything that really in their own Scandinavian landscape. But to see them out in the broader world has been something that I've been intrigued by, and I'm really curious on how they explore that. We do have feedback, so let's hop into the mailbag.
Mail, motherfucker!
What up, Stina? It's Mimi. This is my feedback for Vikings Valhalla, season 2 opener. I am going to make this quick. I don't know why. I just did not feel like doing this feedback this morning, and I had ample opportunity. There's really no excuse. I'm supposed to be leaving for work in the next 7 minutes, so I'm going to try to get this feedback in quick. I'm going to attempt to do it before I drive to work. The drive is only 6 minutes, and usually I talk longer than that, so here we go. I do want to discuss how last season, the one thing I distinctly remember being annoyed with was the fact that Freydis somehow forgot she had a brother. And then we got the reveal of them meeting, and it was very underwhelming. I don't know, maybe in, you know, between the two of them, they knew that they could take care of themselves. And granted, Leif is going through some things right now, so he isn't mentally even in a position to probably even care that Freydis just fucking abandoned him and made a life with Haraldson. I feel like that's not his name. Harald. Whatever. I don't care what you say, he still looked like Chris Evans to me. They look like they, like, he looks more like Chris Evans' brother than Chris Evans' brother. Chris Evans' brother actually looks like him. But whatever. I still see it, no matter how. I try not to. but when they saw each other, she was like, Leif, the end. It's like, we didn't see them catch up. We didn't really see much of anything. And I don't know why, but that shit bothers me. And maybe it bothers me because he came all the way to this area for her. He left Greenland for her and her honor. And then, like, I get she, you know, she left. And I don't know, maybe we're supposed to be under the impression that she did look for Leif. I don't know, but that still bothers me. And I cannot get, just not get, like, I can't get over it. And I don't know, I've tried. But I wish we would have saw how King Forkbeard was able to get the drop on fucking Olaf, because I wanted to see that ass whooping. I don't know if I even mentioned it last season, but I wanted Leif to join Forkbeard and become his enforcer, because he went straight berserk. And I remember you saying what you said about berserkers. I wanted to see that in action. But he became a no man, and he was by himself, just looking like a grizzly bear, murking folks with a bow and arrow. He looked pretty boss, but he also looked sad and depressed and not wanting anybody to talk to him, just looking like he ain't bathed in 6 months. And I think that was the time period that we're supposed to, like, we're supposed to think. I don't remember if they said it, but I know it's been some time. I don't know why, but King Forkbeard put in his son in charge of Kattegat. I don't know. His son looks ridiculous. Like, why is the root of your hair curly, but the base is straight and you're white? His hair looks fucking crazy. And I don't know if they did that on purpose, but it bothers me. are we not going to get any more King Canute? Interesting. I'm trying to figure out. I don't remember. I know he went to war, but I don't remember what triggered it. So if you remember Christina, just jog my memory. But I do like the boss move that King Forkbeard pulled on Olaf, because I feel like Olaf is probably thinking he's got the upper hand, or even that they're even. But I just have a feeling that King Forkbeard is going to turn the tables, because he said one thing I despise is traitors. And he said that King Forkbeard told that one dude, it's like he should be concerned about trusting me. I didn't like how that was the end of that conversation. So it'll be interesting to see what happens from there. What else? So Freydis is pregnant, but she, whatever, because I distinctly remember saying last season that I don't know how this is going to work, because there's no way. Freydis is determined to keep her pagan religion. And we know that Harrelson, I'm going to call him Harrelson because for whatever reason I'm having a brain fart. I can't remember his name. It'll come to me probably for the next episode. But we know that he is determined to be the king of Norway, even though all signs point to, motherfucker, you got to give that dream up. Why don't you set your sights on something else? Like, I understand Olaf promised you, but you got to see that the tides have turned, sir. Not Olaf, King Canute. Your brother was going to give that land to his son, and King Canute has a bunch of sons. So I understand, you know, a king's word is supposed to mean something, but I also feel like he's been betrayed enough that he should understand maybe it's not worth it anymore. I don't know why he's so fucking determined to die over this. It just doesn't seem like it's in his fate. I do predict that, you know, maybe once he finds out that Freydis is pregnant, maybe he'll change his mind. But I also feel like he's not going to renounce Christianity. I know he said his father converted out of necessity. So maybe he can be like Ragnar and live in between the two. I don't know. But I am interested to see what's going on. I am interested to know if Leif is still holding on to Liv. I was happy to see her, but then I remember she was dead. And then I was like, oh, well, shit. I don't want him to be literally chasing a ghost. So this is going to be terrible. Yeah. So we'll see, because he's clearly lost his mind. I guess that him and Leif and Haraldson are on their way to Harald. His name is Harald. There it is. They're on their way to see Harald's uncle, which I guess is fine. I don't remember where they are, but they're going to be on a rowboat. So this will be interesting. I guess if anybody can get them anywhere on a rowboat, it's Leif. So, I guess we'll see. So, like I said, only had 7 minutes, so I am going to end it here. I got to go to work. So, hopefully I got everything out. Otherwise, I'll just attach it to the next feedback for episode 2, which I'm going to watch when I get home from work. So until next time, love, peace, hair grease, and Black Girl Magic. Queen of the Couch, Mimi out.
That was Queen Mimi with her thoughts on the season 2 premiere. You know, I don't care if you do it in your car. I think you brought that up in one of the feedbacks and I never even addressed it, because I was like, I don't give a fuck if there's background noise. That really does not bother me, not one bit. It's sometimes funny if you go in and out like you're underwater, but most of the time you're pretty good. As far as you called him a grizzly bear, and that sums him up so perfectly. That's exactly what he's like, grizzled. But I need the actor to commit to being a berserker, and I don't see the commitment there. Like, he says he's angry, but I don't feel it. It doesn't come across. It feels like he's a wounded puppy more than an avenged angry god. You know what I mean? And that is something I am going to want to see a little bit more from the actor. Or maybe it just doesn't fit him as well to play that. And maybe that's why they're going to take it back a little bit. But yeah, like, I felt he has the look of, the aesthetic of, but it's just not, it's not completely, for me at least, fully packing the punch it should. But like a grizzly bear, that's exactly what I wanted. I wanted to just cuddle him. I want to cuddle him. Yes, he's a little prickly, but for the most part, he's still rather harmless. Even if he did put that knife to that man's throat in a very, and mess with his skin like that, it's just, it's more like actions, and there's no, there's nothing behind the eyes that give me a little bit more to sell it. That's all. She did abandon his ass though, and I'm still not over that as well. I'm really not. So then she just left him again. Cause I felt like even when she sat down and was like, let me tell you this little bit of advice, but here's really what's going on in my life. And yes, I'm sure if he wanted to run off, but as stated, he could, you could have brought up his name. It's been months since I've seen my brother. I wonder if he's okay. You knew what he was about to do in life. I think that that kid, Seven is Aslug 2.0's son, which would make him Forkbeard's grandson. I could be incorrect, but I'm pretty sure he called her mother. So that's Canute's wife, and thus why he probably was like, son, you plan on not keeping this in the family? Well, guess what? I overrode you. You wasn't there, and... I'm negating on your promise, because that is a promise that Canute made behind the back of his own father. So his father certainly didn't have any impotence to honor that. That's exactly what she was trying to tell him. And these are not the same people. I don't recall a lot of Canute being in like England at the time, so we could see him in wars, because that's what he did. He pretty much, he came back, you know, fucked his wife, checked out, you know, had a little brief vacation, but most of his time as king was spent away from England and fighting in different wars. So I would not expect to see this character a lot, but I do want to see him in the season so I can get my zaddy on. I need to get some zaddy up in my life. But seeing the minions run things, that's at least historically accurate. As far as Forkbeard too, I'll be worried about that dude as well. He seems far, far more lenient than Canute. I feel like Canute would make this arrangement, but I feel, yeah, the same thing with that other guy. Like, he said he had plans, plural. And if he has plans, plural, and he's holding every single last card, of course I wouldn't be, of course I would not trust this person. And I do think that he has a far more meaner streak. He's just going to let them hang themselves. It's always better to watch. Yeah, because you don't say I hate traitors and then leave two traitors alive. And they made mention of the fact that, oh, he's getting a very Christian death by hanging versus how we do things, he would have been blood-eagled. So I don't know about Forkbeard, but I would be watching him. I certainly would be watching him. He's way scarier than his son. As far as going back lastly to Harold, maybe he feels like his dream is to unite. Maybe he sees the pagans suffering and he sees the Christians being the persecutors of that, and that's not what he wants to see. That's not the vision he saw for himself or to be the king. But I know the indoctrine part of it. It's not so easy to give up something you feel is ingrained, and you have a legitimate, legitimate thing too. And if it's going to be something to make it better in the future, I suppose, but I'm also really with you though. Like, you can make anything else your dream. This doesn't have to be it, but this is what he wants. This is the place to his power, and he feels like it. He doesn't have to earn it. Well, he did earn it because he did fight in the war for England, a place he didn't have no fucking place. I had no dog in that fight, but I went and I fought it for you, and I bled and I sweat, and I came back to Caddigate fighting for you, and this was the promise. And the thing it is Forkbeard reneged on the promise. Canute probably would have gave him Norway. So in a lot of ways, he's not wrong to not want the one thing in which he has his whole entire life been preparing for. You just don't turn your back on that overnight or even in 6 months. But at the same time, when it does feel like an impossibility, but that's, I think, where we're at, we see it as a little bit of an impossibility where he doesn't see it quite as such at this time. And it isn't, because Olaf is what? There's a puppet, a weak regent, and Olaf. I'll take those odds. Shai is going to join us next episode, I believe. She is in recuperation mode, and I do not blame her, because that's exactly how I felt about yesterday. I came back, I was like, oh, I need to, seriously, I've been too many people. I'm overstimulated. I need to, need a moment, just 20 minutes. And then I'll be damned if my daughter didn't knock on my door to my mommy, and I was like, oh my God. Can not give me a minute to breathe. Anyhow, if you want to send feedback, blackercouch@gmail.com, or you can leave a comment below. Until next time, peace, hair grease, and blacker magic.